الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين، أما بعد. Tonight, inshallah, we intend to cover 4 ahadith in this session, inshallah. And I will present to you a brief summary of those 4 ahadith, what is mentioned in those 4 ahadith, so that will keep you connected to what's coming forward, inshallah. And this will remain the routine for the subsequent sessions. Before we start, inshallah, I will present to you a summary of what is in the hadith, and then we'll go into the details of the hadith, whatever that is, inshallah. Before we go into tonight's session, inshallah, and we start the first hadith for tonight, which will be, by the way, the second hadith of the book, will be the first hadith for tonight, but will be the second hadith of the book. So I mentioned to you on Monday that Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi has mentioned approximately 400 ahadith in this book, 397 to 400. And he has divided all of them into 55 chapters. He has categorized them and put them into 55 chapters. There is a very interesting fact, the way Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi has put the chapters and ordered them. The very first chapter of this book begins with Babu ma ja'a fi khalqi Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, about the description of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how he looked like. And the first hadith was about that, second hadith will be about that, third, fourth. There are about 9 ahadith in this chapter that are all about the physical description of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And you know what the last chapter is? So the first chapter is about the description of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the last chapter is about Babu ma ja'a fi ru'yati Rasulillah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, about seeing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And there's a very subtle connection that Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi had in his mind. As I told you, he is one of the great muhaddith of this ummah. He holds a very lofty position amongst the scholars of this ummah, amongst the muhaddithin of this ummah, and he was a very visionary scholar. So what Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi had in his mind when he was compiling this book, and when he was framing the chapters, and how he put the order in chapters, the first, the second, the third, and the last, there's a very subtle connection that he had in mind. So you begin this book by learning about the appearance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how he looked like. So you start learning about how his face looked like, how his hair looked like, how his hands looked like tonight, and I will present to you what's coming up tonight, inshallah. How his hand looked like, how his feet looked like, how he walked, and how he talked, and all of that. So you start with this chapter, and then you go to the second chapter, and third chapter, and fourth, and fifth, all the way to the end, and you end with the chapter where Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi talks about those ahadith that tell us about seeing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the dream. Obviously, none of us here are fortunate enough to see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in reality while we're awake. But seeing him in the dream, in your dream, is not only a possibility, but it is a reality. So, one subtle connection that Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi had in mind was that as you start this book and you start learning about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam,
If you have sincerity, if you have ikhlas, and if you have the commitment, and if you go through the book as you ought to go through, as you are supposed to learn, then you will have developed enough love of the Prophet ﷺ that at the end, you will see him in your dream. By the end of this book, you will have developed enough love of the Prophet ﷺ in your spirit and in your mind and in your heart that you will see the Prophet ﷺ. Another subtle connection that Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi had in mind in putting the first chapter and the last chapter, that you learn about the Prophet ﷺ from the first chapter, then go through all the way to the 54th chapter. And in the 55th chapter, he reminds you that now, if you see the Prophet ﷺ in your dream, you will have no problem determining and making sure that you are seeing the Prophet ﷺ, because you're learning everything about him. You will learn everything about his description. So you will have no problem in knowing instantly as you see the Prophet ﷺ in your dream that yes, that is the Prophet ﷺ. Because I learned everything about him. I read everything about him. So that is the subtle connection that Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi had. And also we make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes us among those fortunate souls who see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the dream. Because the world of dreams is a different world. And the things that are literally impossible in the real world are possible in that virtual world, are possible in that world of dreams. In our dreams, we see everything. You see those things where you've never been. You see those things that you only think about, you only dream of. So it is possible that Allah allows you to see the Prophet ﷺ in your dream. And the Prophet ﷺ said very clearly, whoever sees me in his dream, he in reality indeed sees me. Because in the shaytan la yatamathalu, shaytan has no power to take up my appearance and appear in someone's dream as if he is faking me, as if he's pretending to be me. He cannot even pretend to be me. Only I am the one who, if I come in someone's dream, it's me. You should know that that is not shaytan, that is not by shaytan, and that is not caused by shaytan. That is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So, the four hadith that we are going to cover tonight, inshallah, the first hadith that is also narrated by Anas bin Malik radiallahu anhu. In that hadith, we'll talk once again about the height of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in slightly different words, and about the beauty of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the beauty of his body, literally his body, and the nature of his blessed hair. We talked about that on Monday as well, but once again, that will come up inshallah. And the color of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, not the color of his hair, but the color of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And finally, in that hadith, we'll learn about the walking style of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is something that you never learned before. It was not mentioned in the first hadith, but in the second hadith, we'll learn about the walking style of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how he used to walk, and I'll explain that. In the second hadith, we'll learn about the shoulders of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that they were broad. They were not narrow, rather the Prophet ﷺ was broad-shouldered and his chest was wide. So he was a wide-body and broad-shouldered man. And the second thing, the density of his hair. The third thing, the length of his hair. The fourth thing, about one particular dress, one particular color of dress, and that is red. The Prophet ﷺ wearing the red color of dress. And the third hadith, we'll learn about the length of the hair of the Prophet ﷺ, which will be different than what you will learn in the second hadith. And I'll explain how it becomes different. And the fourth hadith, we'll learn four things, inshallah, in that hadith. First, the description of the hands of the Prophet ﷺ. Second, the description of the feet of the Prophet ﷺ. Third, the description of the bone joints of the Prophet ﷺ. And the fourth thing, there about the hair on the chest of the Prophet ﷺ, on the front part of the body of the Prophet ﷺ. We'll learn about that in these four ahadith. So let's go into that, inshallah, as we don't have enough time. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. وبه قال حدثنا حميد بن مسعدة البصري قال حدثنا عبد الوهاب الثقفي عن حميد عن أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه قال كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ربعة وليس بالطويل ولا بالقصير حسن الجسم وكان شعره ليس بجعد ولا سبط أسمر اللون إذا مشى يتكفى. This hadith is narrated by Anas bin Malik radiallahu anhu. Anas bin Malik radiallahu anhu, as I told you, is one of the imams of this ummah, one of the four imams. Malik bin Anas radiallahu anhu. Malik bin Anas radiallahu anhu is one of the four imams of this ummah. And Anas bin Malik radiallahu anhu is not related to Malik bin Anas radiallahu anhu. Anas bin Malik radiallahu anhu is a companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So, he is the narrator of the second hadith as well. He was the narrator of the first hadith, which talked about the hair style of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which talked about the color of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which talked about the height of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the second hadith is similar with slight difference. And it is also narrated by Anas bin Malik radiallahu anhu. He says that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was of medium height. The word rab'a means he was of medium height, which again, once again, only highlights what is mentioned in the previous hadith, that he was not too tall and he was not short. Where does that put the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in terms of height? That he was medium height. He was medium height, but his height more towards being tall rather than being short. That's why he said he was not short, but he was not too tall. He was tall, but not too tall, not extremely tall. وَلَيْسَ بِالطَّوِيلِ وَلَا بِالْقَصِيرِ. Once again, he uses the words that the Prophet ﷺ was not very tall and he was not short. حَسَنُ الْجِسْمِ. He had a very beautiful body. He was very handsome. That's what literally حَسَنُ الْجِسْمِ means, that the Prophet ﷺ from top to bottom was very handsome. وَكَانَ شَعْرُهُ لَيْسَ بِجَعْدٍ. And the hair of the Prophet ﷺ was not very curly, وَلَا سَبْطٍ, and was not very straight. Rather, it was slightly wavy. It had slight curl into it. So it was not very straight, and it was not very curly. It was in between. أَسْمَرَ اللَّوْنِ. And the Prophet ﷺ's color had wheat complexion. It had a slight brown color into the color of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In the previous hadith, we learned that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not extremely white, and he was not brown. This hadith only adds to that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not extremely white, and he was not extremely brown. Rather, he had some wheat colored complexion there, which was radiant and which would only highlight the beauty of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Idha masha yatakaffa. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would walk, he would walk while leaning forward. The word yatakaffa used by Anas bin Malik radiallahu anhu has been given three different interpretations by the scholars of hadith. They say the first interpretation, or the first meaning of the word yatakaffa, is to walk while leaning forward. So let me demonstrate that for you. So walking like this. So that's one meaning. And the other meaning of the same word is to walk at a faster pace. So not to walk like very slow, but rather to walk a little bit faster. And the third meaning that the scholars have given to the same word and have interpreted the same word in the third meaning, and that is to walk in a way while lifting the foot with a force and putting it on the ground with a force, not to allow the feet to be dragged, not to go like, rather than going with in a way to put the foot on the ground with a force and to lift the foot with a force. So the scholars say that all three of these characteristics of walking were there in the walking style of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when he would walk, he would bend a little forward. He would lean a little forward. And that was to show the humility. Because arrogant people walk like that, with their chest out in the open. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had the humility and he was humble. So that humility reflected in his walking style. And the other hadith will explain even more that the Prophet ﷺ would often walk as if he was coming from a higher ground to the lower ground. So if you're coming from a higher place to the lower place, you will not come down like that. You would be coming down like that. So the scholars say that all three of these things were there in the walking style of our beloved Prophet ﷺ. The next hadith is narrated by Bara ibn Azib radiallahu anhu. He says, كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم رجلا مرفوعا. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was a man of medium height. Once again, the same thing is being repeated and being emphasized, that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was not too tall and he was not short. He was of a medium height. بعيد ما بين المنكبين. And the Prophet ﷺ had broad shoulders. The distance between his two shoulders was wider than normal people. On average, people have narrow shoulders, and the distance between the two shoulders is not too much. The Prophet ﷺ had wide shoulders, broad shoulders, and he had a wide chest, which was a sign of his strength, and which was a reflection of his strength as well. Azimul Jumma. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had very dense hair. His hair were not thin, his hair were very dense, and he had dark hair, and his hair were always long. He always had long hair. The only time he shaved his head is when he went for Umrah or when he went for Hajj. Other than that, the Prophet ﷺ always had long hair. And what was the length of his hair? That's also mentioned by Bara ibn Azib radiallahu anhu. He says, إِلَى شُحْمَةِ أُذُنَيْنِ. The length of the hair would go up to the ear lobes of the Prophet ﷺ. So his hair, he would comb always. The Prophet ﷺ was very particular. He would always comb his hair. And his wife Aisha radiallahu anha or someone else would apply oil to his hair as well, and then his hair would go all the way to the ear lobes of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then Bara ibn Azib radiallahu anha says that alayhi hullatun hamra, that on that day when I saw him, he had a red dress on him. He was wearing a red dress, a red shawl around his body. مَا رَأَيْتُ شَيْئًا قَطُّ أَحْسَنَ مِنْهُ. And he says, I never saw anything more beautiful than the Prophet ﷺ. He's not saying, I never saw anyone more beautiful than the Prophet ﷺ. He says, I never saw anything more beautiful than the Prophet ﷺ. And the scholars say the reason why he used the word shay-ting, which because he wanted to include everything that is beyond human beings. So including the stars, including the moon, including anything else that could be described as the most beautiful thing in the world. There was nothing more beautiful than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we as believers, we have to believe. The scholars have mentioned, in particular, Shaykh Munawi rahmatullahi alayhi has mentioned that Every believer must believe, must have faith in this fact, that everything that the Prophet ﷺ is described with, all the beautiful characteristics and all the beautiful features of the existence of the Prophet ﷺ, everything that the Prophet ﷺ is described with was not only true, but also no one else can have that. It was only the Prophet ﷺ who had the most beautiful characteristics and the most beautiful and most perfect features of his body and of his existence, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never created anyone before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as beautiful as him, and he will never create anyone after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as beautiful and as handsome as him. And this is our faith, this is our iman, we believe in that. The third hadith is narrated again by Bara ibn Azib radiallahu anhu, same narrator, same companion. He says, مَا رَأَيْتُ مِنْ ذِي لِمَّةٍ فِي حُلَّةٍ حَمْرَاءٍ أَحْسَنَ مِنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. He says, I have never seen anyone wearing a red dress and having long hair, dense hair. I have never seen anyone more beautiful than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wore the red dress and he had long hair. And then same companion goes further describing the length of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Lahu sha'run yadribu mankibayhi. His hair were reaching the shoulders of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So in the second hadith that we learned tonight, the length of the hair was up to the earlobes. Now, the same companion is saying that his hair was reaching his shoulders. So longer hair. And it's not really difficult to understand that sometimes the Prophet ﷺ would trim his hair up to the earlobes, and then sometimes he would allow it to grow all the way up to the shoulders. But never beyond the shoulders. Women have their hair going beyond the shoulders, but the Prophet ﷺ never allowed his hair to grow longer than his shoulders. The shoulders was the maximum length that he would have his hair for, and the minimum that he would have it at was the earlobes. These are the two different lengths that are mentioned here. There's one more that will come later. There's actually a whole chapter on the hair of the Prophet ﷺ in this book. And there's a whole chapter about the white hair that the Prophet ﷺ had at the end. بُعِيدٌ مَا بَيْنَ الْمَنْكِبَيْنِ. Once again, the Prophet ﷺ had broad shoulders and had wide chest. لَمْ يَكُنْ بِالْقَصِيرِ. He was not short. وَلَا بِالْطَوِيلِ. And he was not very tall. And the next hadith, the fourth hadith, is narrated by Ali bin Abi Talib radiallahu anhu. This hadith that we will learn, which will be the last hadith for tonight, inshallah, does not go too far in describing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But one other hadith that will come, narrated by same Ali radiallahu anhu, will bring tears to your eyes. That goes in such details describing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And remember, Ali radiallahu anhu is someone who saw Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from basically the time that he was born. He lived with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for all his life. He grew up at the hands of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he was married to the daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the way he describes the beauty of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it brings tears to the eyes of the listener and the reader. And we'll learn about that in the next session, inshallah. So next hadith is narrated by Ali bin Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, and he says that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam لم يكن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بالطويل ولا بالقصير. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was neither too tall nor short. He was of medium height. شفن الكفين والقدمين. He had his hands and his feet, the soles of his hands and his feet were fully fleshed. So that was a sign of the strength of the hands of the Prophet ﷺ and the strength of the feet of the Prophet ﷺ. His hands were fully, the sole of his hand was fully fleshed, and the sole of his feet were fully fleshed. That's what Ali radiallahu anhu says about the hands and the feet of the Prophet ﷺ. So they were not thin, they were not weak, they were strong hands, and they were strong feet. ضَخْمُ الرَّأْسِ. And the Prophet ﷺ had relatively larger head. Because having a small head is considered a flaw. And having a larger head, relatively larger, not too large, but relatively larger head is seen as a sign of intelligence and a sign of perfection of that person as well. And it was a perfect head. The Prophet ﷺ had the most perfect and the most beautiful head. ضَخْمُ الْكَوَادِيسِ. And his bone joints were also larger. Karadis is the plural of kurdus, and it is a reference to the bone joints, each bone joint in the body, the bone joints in the fingers, the bone joints in the knees. And that was because the Prophet ﷺ was slightly taller, so his hands were bigger, his feet were relatively bigger. All the bone joints in the blessed body of the Prophet ﷺ were larger than ordinary people. Tawilul Masriba. The Prophet ﷺ had a thin line of hair on his chest going all the way to his belly button. A very thin line of hair. And that was also a mark of beauty. A beautiful mark on the blessed body of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. إِذَا مَشَاءْتَ كَفَّأَ. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would walk, he would walk with three characteristics. He would walk fulfilling three things. One, he would walk leaning forward. Number two, he would walk on a bit quicker pace. Number three, he would walk while firmly putting his feet on the ground and firmly lifting the feet from the ground. These were the three things that were in the walking style of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. تَكَفَّأَ كَأَنَّمَا يَنْحَطُ مِنْ صَوَابٍ. And Ali radiallahu anhu describes one of those things. He says, he would walk as if he was coming down from a higher place. And if you're coming down from a higher place, you would be leaning forward, and you would also be walking relatively faster. That was the regular walking style of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then Ali radiallahu anhu says the same thing as Bara ibn Azib radiallahu anhu said, لَمْ أَرَى قَبْلَهُ وَلَا بَعْدَهُ مِثْلَهُ صلى الله عليه وسلم. I never saw anyone before him or after him as handsome, as beautiful as the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And that, usually if you see this kind of statement, it is a kind of exaggeration. If I say to someone, I've never seen someone more beautiful than you, I've never seen someone more handsome than you, most likely it will be exaggeration, or based on my own limited knowledge. But when it comes to the Prophet ﷺ, there is no overstatement. There is no exaggeration at all. This is the reality. This is the truth. That no one was as beautiful as Prophet ﷺ before him, and no one will ever be as beautiful as the Prophet ﷺ after him. وَأَخْرَ دَعْوَنَا الْحَمْدُ لَهُ بِالْعَالَمِينَ. So we'll start from here on Monday from the sixth hadith of this chapter, inshallah. That hadith is also narrated by Ali radiallahu anhu, and that is one of the most detailed descriptions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Wa akhul ghamam alhamdulillah.
Yes.
You mentioned that in that hadith that he was wearing a red colored dress.
Yes.
So what was that? Preferred color for dressing, or like what was his preferred color?
His preferred color was white. He preferred white over everything else, but his beauty would become more visible in a red dress.
So, and when you talk about dress, was it like a full dress or was it just like a red shawl?
It was a red shawl, but his shawl was always really big. So it was covering almost two-thirds of his body. And I'll talk about that briefly when we, there'll be a different chapter on this, and I'll talk about that, inshallah, in more detail.
What kind of red? Is that this type of red? Like this type of red?
No, not this kind of red.